Hey, I'm Brian Fisher, and in this video, I'm going to be mixing an indie rock song from start to finish using the tools in Music Production Suite 5. Music Production Suite 5 is brand new and features a bunch of tools that can speed up your workflow, like Neutron 4 with the new Assistant View, Trash Module, Unmask, and Referencing, as well as Nectar 3 Plus, Ozone 9, and a whole bunch more. You've also got some new entrants to the suite, like a dedicated, super easy to use delay, the BX Delay 2500, that has built-in ducking to make sure that your delay feedback tail doesn't mask your original sound source. There's also the new BX Subsynth, BX Refinement, BX Saturator V2, and BX Clean Suite Pro to give you even more power and precision in your mixing and mastering work. All right, so I'm gonna be mixing today in Logic, and I have all of my tracks imported. It's about 40 tracks in total for a song called Sleepwalking by my band Eastern Souvenirs. And I'm gonna be working with these today. For all you Apple users out there, please know that iZotope's plugins are now natively supported with M1 Apple Silicon, which is awesome. So I am running natively for this session. And as you can see, I've color-coded everything. I've added the little icons, named everything, basically got everything organized. I highly recommend doing this before you start mixing. It's crucial to help you know how to navigate, you know, a session, especially when you have 30, 35, 40 plus tracks involved. I've also started grouping things and doing some of my bus routings. So I'm not going to go over all of that stuff in detail. Just know that that is an important first step, is laying out all your tracks, color coding them, labeling them, getting your bus routing set up so that when it's time to mix, you can just get started and go. On that same note, I've also done editing as well. So for the drums, checking phase, making sure, you know, time alignment is good. For vocals, doing some tuning, doing some cleanup using RX9, which is in Music Production Suite 5, and tuning using Melodyne, which you also get access to in Music Production Suite 5. So that is awesome. I'm not going to feature any of the editing in this video. We're strictly going to be focused on mixing. All right, now that we've got everything situated, I'll give you a quick playback of how it sounds without any panning or any level adjustment or processing of any kind. And here's a sample after I've mixed it. Okay, so when I'm mixing a song, the very first step is always setting the levels, adjusting the panning, and gain staging. Basically, I want to make sure that nothing is clipping, including especially my master bus. I also want to get a rough relationship between all the instruments figured out and also panning relationship as well. This helps me moving forward to be able to really identify what are the problems in the mix, what needs to be enhanced. You can't really have good perspective on that until you have kind of a reasonable balance of everything kind of in view. So an awesome way to set your levels is to use Neutron 4's visual mixer. So I have that pulled up here. So basically, if you put Relay or another iZotope plugin on every single track of your mix, you can then see it visualized in this window here, where you can then adjust the level up and down or the panning left and right on the screen here. There's also a mix assistant that can give you a starting place. You basically let it listen to your whole song and it'll intelligently basically give you a starting mix that you can then adjust visually in this window here. So for reference, here is a section of the chorus without any level adjustment or panning. And here's my mix after I set levels and panning. So you can hear, even just with adjusting levels and panning, already the mix sounds way clearer. You can hear the specific instruments kind of more defined, and they're not walking all over each other. So it makes a huge difference to do kind of a rough mix of the levels and the panning before you ever pull out an EQ or a compressor or anything else. All right, so after I have a rough idea of my levels and my panning scheme, I'll listen to the track start to finish and I'll take notes about things that need to be fixed or improved or enhanced in some way, effects I might want to use, and just kind of the general vibe I want to go in. This is also a good time to listen back to your references to get a clear idea of kind of where you want to go. And once I have this roadmap, it's super helpful when I start diving into further stages of mixing. Okay, so the next thing I typically do in a mix is start with the drums. The drums are usually kind of the foundation of the mix, so we're gonna jump right into that. First, I'm gonna go through and tell you kind of what we're looking at here. So I have a kick out track and I have a kick in sample. So because we didn't have a mic on inside the kick to get kind of the attack of the beater, decided to add a sample. So already did that in the editing process. So that's acting as our kick in. And then we have a bus that is both of those tracks combined. We have snare bottom, snare top, and a snare bus, which is both of the snare tracks combined. We have a floor tom, hi-hat mic, and one mono overhead. And so here is a sample of how the drum kit sounds without any EQ or compression, just some adjustment of levels and panning. All right, so pretty good. I really like the sound of the kit. I'm very happy with the sounds that we got tracking. So no massive work needs to be done, but definitely some cleanup. I want to add a little bit more character and life to these drums. I want to add a little bit more kind of sustain to the snare drum and just kind of the kit in general. It was recorded in a very small room, so gonna have to add some reverb to kind of simulate a larger space and also create a little bit of stereo width. But ultimately, I want to keep kind of a retro sound with these drums, so I'm okay with them feeling a little bit more mono. So you'll notice down here, I have a drum bus. So that is being fed by a handful of buses. So I have a drum crush bus, a drum punch bus, and then the main drum kit. And so all three of these buses are feeding into the drum bus. And we will get to that a little bit later once we go through some of the individual kit pieces, and I'll talk about how I do parallel processing on drums. All right, so first let's talk about the kick drum. So I don't have any processing on the kick out or the kick in individually. It's all on the kick bus. So I'm gonna solo that out and play that back. So right off the bat, listening to that, I know that I wanna do a little bit of adjustment. I want to definitely get as much heft out of the kick drum as I can. Also get, you know, a little bit more attack, so it cuts through the mix a little bit better. I'm also going to want to do some dynamics control to make sure that each kick hit is hitting with the same amount of power. So that's kind of my thought process going into processing the kick. Before I add any EQ or compression, I'm already thinking about what are the problems, what are the things that I want to enhance. So first off, I have Neutron 4 with the added feature of the new track assistant view that you can toggle between. So the cool thing about this view is you have a target curve, just like Tonal Balance Control, that's dependent upon, you know, your selection on the left here. And then you have some intent controls for punch, which is a new type of compressor, distortion, and width. And so I did most of the adjustment just manual on this one, but we can look at some of those features with Track Assistant a little bit later. All right, so let's look at the EQ. So first of all, like I said, I wanted to add a little bit more power to the kick and a little bit more snap. So you can see I boosted the fundamental at 55 hertz, and I also boosted at 2,380 hertz. And so that brings out a little bit of the attack, as well as, you know, bringing out some of those sub frequencies. I did a high pass filter to get rid of some of the lowest sub frequencies that can be a little bit kind of boomy and indistinct sounding. Kept it with a pretty mild slope. You'll also notice a couple cuts in the mid range. There was some boxiness around 500 hertz, about 480. And then I also did some cutting to make some room for the bass. So let's listen without the EQ, and then I'm going to engage the EQ so you can hear the difference. All right, you'll also notice I engaged the soft saturation. So this actually kind of acts similarly to like a console emulation. It adds, you know, a little bit of saturation dependent on how hard you're driving the EQ. So I wanted to just add a little bit of extra character there. The next step is the compressor. So this is really just to tame the kick a little bit, shape the transient, but most importantly, create consistency. I have a longer attack, about 30 milliseconds to let the transient through. 90 millisecond release and a 4-to-1 ratio. And I'm doing about a 80% mix. So I'll play it without the compressor and then I'll bring it in. So pretty subtle, but adds just a little bit of snap. And again, just brings a little more consistency to the performance. The next thing I did is I added the new punch compressor, and I added a little bit of expansion. So if you go up, you get expansion. If you go down, you get compression. Fairly intuitive, and you can get some pretty extreme effects. So this is expansion. It almost sounds like a gate, and then compression. Pretty boomy and a little bit distorted. So I just added a touch of expansion. This is a transient control for the attack. So if you want a sharper transient, you stay towards the bottom. If you want to smooth it a little bit, go towards the top. So I kept it towards the bottom, sustain about halfway. I'll do a before and after. The last step was the exciter, which I used in dual band mode. The lower band is on tube, the upper band is on retro. I just auditioned the different distortion types and decided I liked how those were reacting with the source. I just brought a little bit more heft and kind of a sense of size to the kick drum and also a little bit more presence. So I'll do a before and after of that. Here's without. And with. All right, so that's it for Neutron 4. The next thing I did was just add a little bit of sub-frequency harmonics just to add a little bit more power to the kick drum. Sometimes just using EQ doesn't really give you the kind of energy and power that you want from your kick drum. And so adding some subharmonics with a plugin like this can really help. So this is the BX Subsynth. I actually used a preset on this one that I really liked the sound of it. It's just bass drum, sub punch, edge, and it makes, you know, a pretty good difference if you listen back. So here is without, and then I'm gonna bring it in. Yeah, it just adds a little bit more girth to the kick drum. Okay, moving on, we have the snare bus. Again, I didn't add any processing to the snare top and bottom. I just sort of mixed them to taste, play a little solo of each so you can hear kind of what each track is contributing. And then all together. So yeah, for this, I definitely also wanted to bring some dynamic consistency, a little bit more kind of excitement and sustain out of the snare drum. But there's also some ringing frequencies I can hear in there that I'm gonna have to deal with. So to do that, I'm gonna again bring up Neutron. You can see over here, I have EQ, compression, and the exciter module. I also add Sculptor here as well, which I didn't end up using on this track, but I was just testing it out. So the first step was EQ. So as you can see, I have some pretty big cuts in the mid-range here. I'm gonna do a little before and after so you can hear the ringing that I'm talking about. So this is before EQ. And after. So yeah, it's not completely gone, but it was as much as I could remove without completely scooping the snare drum and getting rid of all the mid-range. So I basically went through and identified sort of the harmonics where the ringing was occurring and then did, you know, pretty significant cuts to those. I didn't use the dynamic EQ function here because I find that on ringing issues on a snare, it doesn't really react with enough sustain to deal with the issue properly. So just doing a sort of deep cut on the frequency that you find the ringing in is kind of the best way to tackle that. I added a little bit of high mid presence at 3200 hertz and a little bump at the fundamental of the snare. So again, I'm gonna bring out the equalizer and then bring it in so you can hear the difference. Again, I have soft saturation going here to add a little bit of subtle harmonics. And the next thing I did was some compression. Again, I did the vintage compressor, similar to the kick, 4-to-1 ratio, 15 millisecond attack, and 75 millisecond release. And let's see how much gain reduction we're getting. About minus 5 dB. So yeah, just enough to add a little snap to the kick drum and kind of even out, you know, the dynamics enough to where they're all kind of punching with the same power. So I'm gonna play this back without the compressor and then bring it in. You can also hear it helped kind of bring out a little bit of the sustain of the snare drum. And I did back that off to about an 80% blend, so a little bit of a parallel compression there so that we're retaining some of the original transient as well. And then the last step was adding a little bit of excitement, just one band on this. A mixture of tape and tube was kind of giving me the right attitude, and I did a, you know, close to a 50-50 blend. So again, I'm gonna play this back, the exciter bypassed, and then bring it in. And that was pretty much all the processing that I did on the snare drum. The only other thing that I did was add a send effect. So I have a snare plate going here. And for this, I used Neoverb, but I also used the gate in Neutron. So that way, basically, we're only getting reverb on the snare hits, and we're not getting it on any of the other drums or cymbals that are bleeding through. So I will solo that so you can hear just the gated sound that is being sent to the reverb. And there's the plate reverb. And then I used Imager to narrow the stereo image of the reverb a little bit. So I'm going to do a before and after of the snare without reverb and then with. So I know that sounds like a lot, but in the context with some of the other parallel buses, it actually is a little bit more subtle. Okay, so the next thing we have is the floor tom here, and we only have a couple of those hits in this whole track, just a couple drum fills. So I will play the section where it comes up so you can hear it on its own without any processing. Okay, so all I did for processing is pull up Neutron 4, and I actually went to the track assistant mode. I had it learn from the signal and suggest a combination of modules. From there, I used the punch module to add some compression. I kept the same distortion that was recommended, and I went in here to kind of tweak a little bit. So you can see it added a sculptor. It identified it as a tom drum. Some EQ. It found kind of an ugly mid-range frequency to cut out. And a couple layers of compression. Here's some parallel compression and the punch compressor, and then some multiband excitement as well. And here is a before and after. So yeah, you can see definitely added some good presence and a little bit more heft, so you get a little bit more tone out of it. Okay, so the next thing I want to look at is the hi-hat. So I used Neutron 4 EQ on this. All I did is cut out a little bit of the low end that was bleeding through, get rid of some of that snare ring that was bleeding into this mic, and kind of boost a little bit of sort of the upper mid-range to kind of bring out a different character in the hi-hat. I also attenuated just a tiny bit of everything kind of above, you know, 12K. Just to kind of soften the high frequencies a little bit so they didn't sound too modern. So here's a before and after of that. All right, moving right along. Last but not least is the mono overhead. And that forms our full drum kit here. So for this, I also used Neutron 4, of course. Cut a little bit of the low frequencies below 100 hertz. Got rid of, you know, some of the honky frequencies and kind of ringing frequencies from the snare. Added a tiny presence boost and then some compression really to tame the transients and bring out a little bit more of the sustain of the snare drum and the cymbals. I kept the ratio a little bit lower, 2-to-1, just using the modern compressor. So I'm going to play this audio back and bring in each module one at a time so you can hear what they're adding to the sound. All right, and here is the full drum kit together with all the processing that I just demonstrated. Okay, so like I mentioned, this is definitely a very mono drum recording. So the next thing that I did is find a reverb that suited it. So I used Neoverb. I used the reverb assistant that you can see here, dialed in the settings based on what sounded good in real time, and then clicked next. So that basically created some custom suggestions for me based on the signal. So it changed the pre-EQ and post-EQ. I went ahead and cut the low frequencies out even more, and I also attenuated some of the high frequencies of the reverb as well to kind of darken it, just to kind of adjust the tone and control kind of what parts of the drum are being sent to the reverb as a whole. Have 18 seconds of pre-delay on there, and doing kind of a mixture of, you know, the chamber and the reflections algorithm. And so I'm going to go ahead and play the drums back, and I'm going to mute the reverb, and then I'm going to bring it in. So yeah, you can instantly hear it really adds to the stereo width and sense of space. Again, these drums were recorded in a very small room, so this kind of created the illusion that they were recorded in a bigger space and have a little bit more dimension and life to them. All right, so after I treated the individual channels, I did some work on kind of the drum kit bus as well with all the pieces together. For this, I brought up the drum kit. I went over to the track assistant and kind of looked at the tone match curve to see kind of where things were sitting. I had it dial in some suggestions for me and ended up kind of tweaking them a little bit from there. So let me play this back so you can actually see kind of the tonal curve and where it's sitting. So yeah, you can see this is my signal compared to the orange target. It's looking pretty good to me. I used the intent controls to adjust some of the punch compression and to bring down some of the distortion and add a little bit of width to it as well. If we go over to the module view, I went ahead and dialed back the sculptor quite a bit, but ultimately liked kind of what it was doing to the signal as a whole. So I will show you a little before and after with sculptors. You can hear what it's doing. So yeah, it's pretty subtle, but it's bringing out some of the mid-range. It's attenuating, you know, some of the upper kind of mid-range, getting rid of a little bit of the harshness. Then we have the EQ. This is fairly minimal as well. A slight bump in the upper mid-range to kind of bring some presence back to it. A little bit of a scoop at 440 hertz and at 180. So this was just kind of reducing the fundamental of the snare a little bit. I think the suggested setting was minus 3 dB, but I wanted to bring a little bit more heft back to the snare, so I reduced it to minus 1. Here is without EQ, and then I'm going to bring it in. All right, next up is compression. So there is two different compressors going. One is a multiband. So the lower band has a fast attack, a fairly fast release, 4-to-1 ratio. The upper band has a little bit slower attack and a faster release, and again, a 4-to-1 ratio. Both of them are in parallel. This was just to kind of add a little bit more density to the drums and wanted to retain, you know, more of the high frequency transients. So had a little bit of a slower attack there. And then the second compressor is another multiband, but using the punch compressor. And so this one was controlled again by this sort of intent control on the assistant side. So it basically set it for me, and these were kind of the individual settings that it came out with. Here is how those two compressors sound. I'll bring them in one after another. And then last, have the exciter module. So I have a lower band on retro and upper band also on retro. Dialed in, you know, a similar amount for both, you know, similar mix. Ultimately, started just kind of experimenting, and that was the balance that I arrived at. So it ended up not being that different between the low and high. But here's what that sounds like. I'm gonna bring it in. So yeah, you can hear kind of a big difference in terms of just adding a lot more presence and kind of aggression to the snare. So I'm gonna play this back with everything bypassed and then bring everything in. All right, so now it's time to talk about parallel bus processing. So I sent the drum kit as a whole to two additional buses, each with kind of a different character and function. So I have the crush, which is just tons of compression, distortion, kind of really, you know, smashing it to pieces as it sounds. And then punch, which is emphasizing the transient. So it's almost exaggerated to the point of sounding gated, but it's sort of bringing some of that transient information back. So let's look at the crush bus. I'm gonna go a little quick through this. So we have compression, 10-to-1 ratio, super fast attack, fast release, you know, quite a bit on the vintage module. We have the exciter in multiband mode, so I can do a little bit less to the low end and a little bit more to the high end. I'm using trash, kind of right in between overdrive and clipper. Sounds super awesome and aggressive. Then a little bit of EQ to get rid of some of the mid-range and bring up some of the low end and the presence. So after I do saturation, oftentimes, you know, it'll bring out more of the mid-range, and so I'll have to tame that back a little bit. And then some transient shaping just to add a little bit more sustain to the high frequency information, like the snare drum and the cymbals. So I'm gonna bring these modules in one by one so you can hear what they're each contributing. So yeah, you can hear pretty gnarly distortion and compression going on there, but then I just blend that in pretty gently with the main bus. Okay, so the next parallel bus is the punch one. Like I mentioned, this one is to emphasize the transients, so we have a little bit of distortion to add some character. We have the punch compressor actually in expansion mode with a little bit less sustain and a sharper attack, again, almost giving you that kind of gated sound. I had different settings for the low and the high, just kind of dependent on the material. I wanted the kick to be a little bit less sharp than the snare and the rest of it. And then some EQ to bring out some of the low end and some of the high end to kind of give it a little bit of a smiley face EQ. And then transient shaper, this time to just bring out just even more attack. So the effect will be, you know, fairly dramatic. I'm gonna play this back and bring in each module one by one. So again, here is a before and after of everything. All right, so that's it for the parallel buses. Now let's listen to the blend of everything together. Okay, so here's a before and after with all the plugins bypassed, and then I'm gonna bring them back in. Okay, now that we have the drums in place, I am going to move on to percussion, and there's quite a bit of it. As you can see, we have some rattles, we have congas, clave, shakers, snaps, claps, and finger chimes, or finger cymbals. So I've already done the panning and level adjustments, and now it's time to dig a little deeper into the processing. So just as reference, I am going to solo all of the percussion and play it back for you. All right, so that gives you an idea of what we're working with. And right off the bat, I can tell that I'm gonna need to do some high pass filtering to get rid of some excess low end. I'll probably apply a lot of high pass filters to other stuff too, just in case to get rid of excess sub frequency information and kind of rumbles that might be there in the recording. But first, let's zoom in on the rattles. So I'm gonna play this back again in solo. We have three different tracks. We have center, left, and right, so it creates kind of a nice stereo spread of that instrument. So these tracks are all the same. It's just the performance was recorded three times so that it could sound a little bit thicker. So I'm not gonna do any individual processing. I'm gonna treat these as a group. And I know I want to add a little bit of ambience to this so it sounds like it's in a little bit of a bigger room and space. So I'm definitely gonna be adding some reverb. I also probably am gonna add some compression just to bring down some of the initial transients and add some density to this. I might even reduce some of the high frequencies just to give it a chunkier, thicker sound. So let's pull up Neutron and look at the moves I did in the equalizer. Like I said, I have a low cut here. So just getting rid of, you know, any kind of low information and rumbling that might have gotten into the recording. I have a little bit of a presence boost, so this kind of emphasizes more the chunky mid-range of the shaker. And then I reduce with a high shelf some of the highest frequencies above 12K just to kind of soften it and make it sound just a little bit more pushed back in the mix. So here is how the EQ sounds. I'm going to play it and then bring it in. So yeah, fairly subtle, but helps just kind of push it back a little bit in the mix. And the next step, the compressor, is gonna help me do that even more. I have a 4-to-1 ratio using the modern mode on the compressor module. Fast attack, fast release, and this is just really pushing down those transients. So I'm doing about an 80% blend of wet and dry, so I'm gonna play it without compression and then bring it in. There we go. So that was all I did in terms of Neutron. And then of course I added a little bit of reverb. We have Neoverb. So this is the reverb I'm using on all the different percussion instruments. I like to send instrument groups to the same space, any instruments that have a similar kind of tonal characteristic. So for this, I have a blend of the reflections algorithm and the chamber. I'm doing a little bit of pre-EQ just to get rid of any low frequencies and low mids to make sure that no low frequencies are triggering the reverb and no super high frequencies are triggering the reverb. Here's what it sounds like dry, and then I'm going to bring in the reverb. And next, we have some congas. So I'll play these back in solo so you can hear them again. So kind of a cool stereo thing going on. You know, each of the conga parts is a little bit different, but kind of following, you know, generally the same rhythm. So gives you a nice kind of stereo feel. So for this, I wanted to adjust the tonal balance a little bit, make sure that they have good snap and presence, but I also wanted to kind of bring a little bit more heft to them. First off, we have Sculptor that we'll focus on. So I think the best way to show you kind of what this is doing is just to play it back. So I'm going to play this back and then bring in Sculptor. You can see it's kind of bringing up a little bit of the low end, getting rid of some of the mid-range, and then also expanding some of the high end to kind of keep some of that snap. So I ended up playing around with the slider in different amounts and kind of landed on this. So here's what it sounds like. Really extreme. It's a little bit too thin sounding. And that's a nice balance. I brought up the speed at which it was reacting a little bit too. And yeah, I liked kind of what it was adding to the signal. I like to try out Sculptor on a lot of instruments before I pull up the EQ to see if it solves the issue in a more effective way. For EQ, all I'm doing is rolling off some of the really low frequencies. I didn't want it to get in the way of the bass or the kick drum, so I just did a low pass. So I'll play that back and bring it in. And I also have some soft saturation going on there. The last stage was compression. So again, I have a really fast attack, fast release, and a moderate ratio of 4:1. I'm using the vintage module for this to get a little bit more character out of it. And doing some parallel processing. I want it to feel a little bit more, you get some of the more tonal information out of it. So I'll play it back and bring in the compressor. And there you go, that's everything for Neutron 4. And then I added a little bit of reverb. There we go, and the next track we have Clave. And I really didn't do a whole lot to this. If you bring up Neutron, I did a high pass filter and that's about it. And then I added a little bit of Neoverb as well, so it's living in the same space as everything else. So here is it with reverb added. And that is the clave. So I'll play those three together so you can kind of hear how they play off of each other. And then next we have shakers. So I have two different performances of shaker that are doubled. So I pan them a little bit left and a little bit right to get somewhat of a stereo spread here. So I'm gonna play that back for reference. And for the shakers, all I wanted to do was a little bit of EQ, rolled off some of the low end like I did before. You know, same reason, just to get rid of any sub-frequency information we don't need. And I added a little bit of kind of high mid-range. So if I play this back, I'm boosting kind of the chunky upper mid-range presence of the shaker. So it just made them sound a little bit, you know, thicker. I also engage the saturation, and I'm gonna bypass and then bring this EQ in. And then I added some of the same reverb. So here's what that sounds like. Okay, so moving right along, we have snaps. Like I mentioned, there's a little bit of kind of low end I wanted to cut out of this, but I'll play it back in solo for reference. Okay, so the first thing I did is the high pass filter, and then I also did a little bit of a kind of mid-range boost to give it a little bit of a different tonal quality to the snap. I also brought up a little bit of the high shelf just to hear a little bit more of kind of the detail of the snap. So altogether, here's what that sounds like. So yeah, you can hear right below 100 hertz how much was going on there. And then I added a little bit of excitement just to kind of add a little bit more thickness in a different way. I added some tape saturation and it seemed to do the trick. I'm gonna play this back and bring it in. And then, of course, added some reverb. And that is your finger snaps. Okay, so the next thing was the hand claps. So I have a clap sample and then two tracks of real claps. And so just to enhance stereo width, I hard panned those. And here's what that sounds like without processing. So the sample sounds a little bit, you know, almost gated, like a little bit choppy. So the reverb is definitely gonna help with that. I also just wanted to kind of glue these together a little bit more. So used EQ, rolled off some of the low frequencies just to kind of thin out the sound a little bit. Here's what that sounds like. And then I use the exciter again to kind of bring a little bit more density and thickness to the signal. Tape saturation, about 50% blend. So I'm going to bring that in. And then added some reverb, which really helped kind of make it a bit more natural and put it in a physical space. And there you go, hand claps. Okay, and last but not least is the finger cymbals. So I'm gonna play that in solo so you can hear it. And all I did was roll off a little bit of kind of the low end. Again, there's nothing down there. It was just kind of just in case. So yeah, you can see a little bit of kind of rumbling information down there. And then added some Neoverb. So here's how that sounds. And there you go. So that is all of the percussion. Now here is how that sounds in context with the drums that we also just mixed. All right, so the next thing we're gonna look at here is the bass guitar, and we just have a bass DI track here, so we're not dealing with any mic'd amps or anything like that. Here's what that sounds like by itself. Awesome. So sounds pretty good as it is. It's definitely a very kind of mellow, round sound. It was recorded on a bass with flat wound strings, so there's not too much buzziness. However, I am hearing a little bit too much click from kind of when the palm muting happens. There's a little bit too much of a high-end attack on that. So I am going to want to roll off some more high frequencies and kind of overall just give it a little bit more grit. If you haven't been able to tell yet, I definitely like using saturation in mixing. You could probably tell from the super crunchy drums that we mixed earlier. So I'm going to do the same to the bass guitar so it has kind of a similar vibe. I also want to kind of beef up the low end, but also kind of clean it up so it's not interfering with the kick drum. So let's pull up Neutron 4. And the first thing that we're looking at is the equalizer module. So I did a high pass around 45 hertz just to get rid of some of the super sub frequencies that I want to kind of completely leave to the kick drum. I also did a bit of a dip at 55 hertz or so, 56, just to make space for the kick drum. I remember that the fundamental of the kick drum was right around kind of 55 hertz. And then I also did a shelf boost at 200 hertz just to kind of bring up some of the low mid-range and kind of let the bass feel very thick. I definitely want the bass guitar to kind of dominate this region of the mix frequency-wise. I don't know, I feel like usually around 300 hertz I'll look to cut a little bit from bass guitar in general. And then I gave it a little bit of presence at 1100 and did a roll-off around 5600 hertz. Okay, so for the next module, I wanted to add some compression just to bring some more dynamic consistency to the bass guitar and kind of emphasize some of the sustain. So you can see even in the waveform, it's a pretty dynamic file. Like this first transient is huge compared to the rest. So I definitely want to rein that in while still keeping the punch of the bass intact. So to do that, I used the compressor module in punch mode. You can see I kind of went down into the compression section here versus expansion, which is up top. And I played around with the attack, ended up kind of at a little bit of a middle of the road setting with the attack and quite a bit of sustain. And I ended up doing an 85% blend of that. So I'm going to play this back and bring in the compressor so you can hear how it affected the signal. And the next module is the exciter. So this is where I wanted to add a little bit of that crunchy, kind of saturated character to the bass. Since it wasn't recorded through an amp, it doesn't have any of that kind of grit that you might find through a bass amp. So I used the exciter in two-band mode so that I could add a lot more distortion to the higher frequency information and keep the low end intact. And so I'm using the tube mode, the tube algorithm for the saturation, and dial that up quite a bit and then kind of mix that down. I'm going to play this back so you can kind of hear what it's doing to the signal, and then I'm going to solo each band so you can hear them individually. So yeah, that's the kind of crunchy high frequencies. That's at 100%. And that's in parallel. I also suppressed some of the high frequencies with this tool here. So you can... use that basically to kind of push down some of the higher frequency harmonics being generated. Here's the low band. So for this, I just dialed in a little bit of the warm algorithm. Here's without. And with. And this last module is a brand new one. It's called Unmask, and it does just what it sounds like. It helps unmask a signal. So if you have competing instruments like bass guitar and kick that are occupying a similar frequency space, Unmask can help you kind of sort that out. So as you can see below, it says route a sidechain signal of the track you want to unmask. So in this case, I want to unmask the kick drum. So I want to make sure that the bass guitar isn't kind of clouding the attack of the kick drum. So Unmask is going to help me basically attenuate parts of the bass signal so that it gets out of the way of the kick drum and can really let the kick drum shine. Okay, so the best way to really show you what it's doing, I'm going to need to bring in the kick drum. So I have my kick bus and the bass guitar, and I'm going to play this back and bring in the Unmask module so you can kind of hear the difference. So here is without Unmask. And with. So you can see the two different signals here in this space competing. And you can see how it's attenuating the bass in this low mid section. So another great thing is you have this slider, so you can only affect the frequencies you want to affect on the bass guitar. So in this case, I wanted it just to kind of focus on things down in the low mid range. You know, let's place it around, you know, 200. So I just dialed in a subtle amount just to get them out of the way of each other just enough, but I don't want to change the tone of the bass too much or have obvious kind of pumping effects. And the last thing that I did to the bass guitar was typically for any bass guitar recording that's DI and you don't have a mic'd amp, I like to add a sense of kind of width and space to it so it doesn't sound so kind of immediate and direct, but sounds like it exists in a room, in a physical space. So for this, I actually used the BX delay 2500, and I dialed in a very fast delay, 40 seconds on the left, 40 milliseconds on the left, and 50 milliseconds on the right. I have these hard panned. I have the feedback at zero, so I'm just getting a quick slap back, and I ended up adding a little bit of modulation as well. Dialing in a little bit of chorus, and let's see, is there anything else? Oh, one thing to note as well is you have high pass and low pass filters. So I high passed this at 337 hertz just to make sure that I wasn't getting stereo slapback happening in like the sub frequencies or like the real low end. And then I also low passed it just to kind of roll off more of the high frequencies so it wasn't immediately obvious that there's a delay on the bass. I just wanted to create kind of a sense of width and space. So I'm gonna play this back and then bring in the delay. All right, so next we're gonna start mixing the guitars. And one thing I wanted to mention is that when I'm mixing, I'm not doing it just in solo. I'm listening to the tracks in context to make sure that they work well together. Just because they sound good on their own doesn't mean they're gonna sound good with everything else, because you run into kind of frequency masking between instruments and stuff like that. So with that in mind, I'm gonna play back all of the guitars in context with the drums, percussion, and bass that we already mixed. Just to give you an idea of what you're listening to, we have an acoustic guitar verse, acoustic guitar chorus, which consists of a left and a right double. And then we also have an electric guitar slide, main melody and harmony, and then another electric guitar part in the chorus here as well. So I'm gonna play back the intro, and then I'm gonna play a little bit of the chorus so you can hear all of those parts in context. And here's the chorus. So already I can hear that there's kind of way too much low end in the acoustic guitars. That's really cluttering up the mix. So we're gonna have to do some EQ work there. With the electric guitars, I definitely wanna bring out some more sustain and give them some ambience, some reverb to kind of fill up the space they're in and give them a little bit more stereo width in the mix. Overall, they're sounding pretty good though. But let's dive into the individual tracks. So first off, we're going to look at the acoustic guitar in the verse. So here it is in solo. So you can hear it sounds almost a little bit muffled. It's definitely a darker recording. So I want to take out some of the low end and kind of bring a little bit more presence and kind of a high frequency shelf to kind of really accentuate the detail of the finger picking in the guitar. So we're gonna bring up Neutron 4. And the first thing I did was add the sculptor module. When I know that significant tonal adjustments need to happen, I'll typically reach for sculptor first to see if it can solve the problem for me. Sometimes in a way that EQ can't quite achieve since it's a more dynamic processor. So I am going to play this back to show you what it sounds like. Some quick notes. I have this selected on acoustic guitar. I dialed this in to about 68%, adjusted the tone so it's a bit brighter, and so the attack and release times are a little bit faster. So you can hear it definitely brought out a lot more high frequency detail and kind of clarity in articulation. So I really like what it's doing there. I think we still need to make some adjustments though. So bring up the equalizer. You can see that, first off, I did a high pass filter to cut out pretty much everything below 100 hertz. So it doesn't get in the way of the bass guitar and the kick drum. And then I also did a low shelf just to kind of further attenuate the low mid-range to give more space for the bass. I also did a notch around 457 hertz to get rid of kind of a weird, resonant frequency that was making it sound a little boxy. And then I brought up some presence around 2200 hertz and a high shelf at 5300 hertz. And this one is dynamic, so my intention here was I wanted to bring a little bit more clarity, but I didn't want it to get out of hand. So dynamically, it's compressing the high frequencies when it crosses the threshold so it doesn't get out of hand. I also have a dynamic band right here at 240 hertz where I can get a lot of boominess out of the guitar. So here is how that sounds. I'm going to play this back without EQ and then bring it in. So yeah, it might sound a little bit thin on its own, but it really helps it cut through the mix. The next thing I did was add the exciter. and add some tape saturation just to, again, further kind of enhance the presence of the guitar to make sure it really cuts through the mix. I dial this in to, you know, a fair amount of harmonic distortion and then 64% blend of wet and dry. And I have this in clear mode. So I'm gonna play this back and then bring it in. I have some parallel compression. I'm using the vintage module, a 4-to-1 ratio, fast attack, fast release, and I dialed that in to about 70%. Because I'm using it in parallel, it's letting a little bit of the transient through, but it's evening out everything dynamically so that it can really stand out in the mix and doesn't get lost. So I'm gonna play this back and bring it in. And then the next thing was finding a reverb for the acoustic guitar and really all the guitars. So again, I have Neoverb here, and I used a combo of the plate and the hall reverb. You can see I did some pre-EQ to get rid of some low end and a little bit of high end for the signal going into the reverb. I like to do that because it helps kind of clean up the reverb in a way that sounds a bit more natural. I also did some further attenuation of kind of the low mid-range and low frequencies and some of the high frequencies on the reverb tail as well. So here's how that sounds. All right, so that is the acoustic guitar verse. Now let's go to the chorus. So I process these through the bus. There's no individual processing on the left and the right channel. I'm gonna play this back in solo so you can hear how it sounds on its own. So again, a lot of the same issues are in this as well. So I did basically the same processing module. I used Sculptor. The only difference here is that I brought over this band here so that it wouldn't boost the low end. I knew that I was gonna cut a lot of that out anyway. And beyond that, a lot of this looks the same. I attenuated a little bit more of the high end here on the EQ and added tape saturation in parallel and then a little bit of compression. This time around, I didn't do it in parallel. I was okay to kind of reduce some of the transients. I was using a guitar pick on this, so there's a little bit more of an attack to the guitar that I wanted to kind of cut down a little bit. So I have about a 10 millisecond attack time, which lets a little bit of that through, but also kind of helps tame it. So I'm gonna play this back and bring in each module one at a time so you can hear how they're contributing to the overall sound. I also added a little bit of reverb, so here's how that sounds. Again, it's the same reverb that I applied to the previous track, and here's how that sounds in context. All right, moving right along, we have the slide guitar. So I'm gonna play this in solo. So overall, I really like the tone. I love the super washed out sound with the spring reverb. I might want to bring a little bit more presence to it. I also want to compress this because I want the sustain of the slide guitar to come through a little bit more in the mix. So I'm going to pull up Neutron, and I added a little bit of a presence boost at just a little over 6K, almost 7K. There was some harsh frequencies happening around 1400 hertz. So I have a dynamic band here attenuating that. That's mainly just kind of in the initial attack of the slide guitar. So I'm going to play this back and then bring in the EQ. Okay, so the next thing I added was a compressor. I have this in modern mode, 4-to-1 ratio, pretty fast attack and fast release. I'm just trying to bring more sustain to it so it kind of cuts through the mix a little bit more. The initial transient really cuts through, but then it gets a little bit lost, so I'm trying to even that out a bit. So I'm gonna play this back and bring in the compressor. So yeah, a lot more sustain. And then I added a little bit of the same reverb we're sending the acoustic guitars to. I just wanted them to kind of live in the same acoustic space and also kind of bring a little bit of stereo width there. So here's how that sounds. And then we have rinse and repeat for the slide harmony, since it's, you know, basically the exact same, just playing a different part. So here's how those sound together. And then we have the electric guitar in the chorus. So this is a little bit different. It's on the bridge pickup, and it has definitely a lot more attack to it, and it's not using a slide. Here's how it sounds on its own. So yeah, I do want to bring a little bit more presence to it so it cuts through the mix. You can see I also rolled off some of the low frequencies in there. So I'm going to play this back and bring in the EQ. And then we have the compressor. So this is on vintage mode, 4-to-1 ratio. I have a little bit slower attack than the slide because I want to keep a little bit more of that transient. I have close to 100 millisecond release time, and I have that in peak detection mode. So I wanted to tame the dynamics, add more sustain, but not lose all of the transient. Here is how that sounds with compressor. And then adding Neoverb, same reverb as the others. And then here is the guitar in context. We'll be right back. All right, so now we're gonna move into mixing the keyboards, and we have a mixture of some kind of electronic piano, some soft synths, vibraphone, Mellotron, and then some kind of combo organ and like 70s funk clavinet, and then a harp sample. I'm just gonna include these all in the general group of keys, and I will solo them and play them back together, because a lot of these parts are kind of closely working together melodically, and the layers are kind of building on each other. So I'll play you a couple different sections. Here's the intro. And then here is the chorus section. So yeah, a lot of awesome textural parts that complement what the guitars are doing, but also add their own vibe. So now let's kind of jump in to the processing. We're gonna zoom in first on the electric piano. So this is kind of a Wurlitzer Rhodes-esque kind of software instrument, but we have it printed here, so it has some of its own effects on it. I'll play it in solo so you can hear how it sounds. So yeah, it's an electric piano sound. It's got a little bit of modulation on there. I think some phaser. So it's sounding really good. That's the one thing about software instruments in general is typically you don't really need to go to town processing them. They sound good right out of the gate because that's kind of how they're designed. So for this, I just use a pretty simple chain here. I just have some EQ. I wanted to add a little bit of saturation, so I have the exciter as well as I engage the soft saturation on the EQ, and I'm just doing a high pass filter to get rid of some extra low end. So I'll play this back and I'll bring in the EQ. So yeah, not much of a difference, and it's not designed to change the tonality too much, just kind of get rid of some of the inaudible energy down in the low frequencies. And then next we have the exciter module. I did the tape saturation mode. I basically just wanted to play around and figure out some saturation that would give it a little bit of edge, a little bit of presence, and the tape saturation algorithm was really doing it for me. I have it set in full mode, which just gives it, yeah, a little bit more of a full sound, emphasizing the low mids. So I will play it and then engage the exciter. So there you have it. And then a little bit of reverb. I just wanted to use kind of the same reverb as the guitars because it was kind of a nice shorter reverb sound. I wanted to give it a more of a physical sense of space so it sounds like it's kind of fitting in with the rest of the track. So here it is with Neoverb. So that's the electric piano. Next we have a software synthesizer called 6mm Dream Sequence. This is actually one that's native to Logic, but again, it's printed here, and this is what it sounds like on its own. So yeah, it has some reverb built into it, but I also wanted to kind of put it in another reverb, even if they have their own kind of reverb built in. I just wanted them all to kind of live and swim in the same reverb a little bit. And this part's supposed to be pretty washed out anyway. So I created kind of a longer tailed reverb for it. And then the processing, again, not really much going on beyond a high pass filter to get rid of some of the low end. So I am going to play this back and I'll bring in the EQ and then I'll turn on the reverb as well so you can hear that. So there you go. That is the Dream Sequence synth. So together with the piano. And then this synthesizer is actually working really closely with the next instrument, which is the vibraphone. They're playing the exact same part. And here's how that sounds on its own. So yeah, it's a vibraphone instrument with a little bit of tremolo that has some kind of stereo aspects to it as well. And so this is supposed to kind of blend in with the synthesizer and really add to the attack of that and kind of the atmosphere of it, make it feel a little bit more organic. So again, there's not too much to do here. I wanted to make it a little bit more lo-fi and emphasize the attack. So I have a boost in the upper mid-range around 5K and then a roll-off around 10K. And then I rolled off the low end around 100 hertz just to make sure there's not really any kind of sub-frequency stuff going on. So I'll play this back and bring in the EQ. And then, of course, adding a little bit of the long tail reverb that we added to the synthesizer as well. Here's how that sounds. And with the synth. All right, moving right along, we have Mellotron flutes. So this part comes in kind of the outro of the chorus, and here's how that sounds. So yeah, not too much to do on this. I boosted a little bit of upper mid-range just to help it stand out a bit in the kind of layers that it's competing with. And then, you know, rolling off a bit of low end. So play that back. Very minimal. And then some long tail reverb with that. And I have this panned a little bit to the right to kind of give it its own sense of space. And so it doesn't get completely lost in the mix of everything else. Because when you bring all of these layers in, it's quite a bit. So that way it kind of has its own space. And I like doing kind of a, you know, maybe 25-35% pan versus, you know, hard panning all the time, because it sounds a bit more natural. It gives it its own place in the mix. But yeah, it doesn't sound, you know, super crazy and exaggerated. All right, so the next thing is the 70s funk clav and the combo organ. And I kind of, these are kind of, they go together. They're part of the same part, similar to the synthesizer and the vibraphone. So I'll kind of talk about them as one unit I'll play them individually though. So here's the funk clavinet. So you can hear it has some spring reverb kind of baked into the sound. And then you have a combo organ as well. So this is kind of like a farfisa, that sort of thing. It also has some spring reverb, it sounds like, in there. It gives it a very retro sound. And I have these panned to the right pretty far. And they're sort of paired with the electric guitar in the chorus. So I have the electric guitar panned to the left and the keyboards on the right, and it creates kind of a nice stereo spread without feeling lopsided. So here are those together. And in terms of processing, again, the sounds were pretty, you know, pretty much there. I just did a low roll off for the clavinet and attenuated some of the mids where it can get a bit congested. So here's how that sounds. And then I added some Neoverb. Combo organ, similar kind of deal. So we have just a high pass filter. So I'll play this back. And then some reverb on that. So here's how they sound together. Last but not least, the harp sample. So this is just a transitional effect. So I'll play this in solo. So yeah, a transitional effect. It has some delay kind of printed on it. Again, just a high pass filter. Not really, you know, doing too much there. And then the long reverb. So yeah, it gives it kind of a nice glow. And I will play kind of all of that back together with everything that we've already mixed so you can hear it in context. All right, so next we're gonna talk about vocals. So vocals are pretty much the crux of any mix, provided it's not an instrumental mix. And we have, you know, a good amount of layers here. You can see I have a lead vocal, have a double of the lead in the choruses, and then have some harmonies, both kind of left and right doubles. And then in the end, some background vocals, some oohs for atmosphere. Like I mentioned earlier, all the editing has been done. So kind of the vocal comp, you know, some additional cleanup, which I usually do in RX standalone. You also get Melodyne Essential with Music Production Suite Pro, which, you know, if you've been doing music production for any time, you've heard of Melodyne, you know it's an industry standard for vocal pitch correction. I did a little bit of tuning with that as well. So this vocal is good to go and we're ready to kind of start shaping it to the track. I'm going to show you kind of what the vocals sound like. So I'll pick a section where they're kind of all going at once. Let's go to the second chorus. I don't want to fall asleep. I don't want to live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand,
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that, wandering aimlessly, watching the time slip through my hands.
So they sound, you know, pretty solid on their own. In the context of the mix, the vocals sound a little bit dark, definitely need some kind of brightening up, a little bit more presence and kind of sheen to them so they really pop through in the mix. I have the vocal double that's going to be kind of supporting the main vocal. So my goal with that will be just kind of getting it to blend really well underneath the lead vocal and support it, but not kind of distract from the main vocal. And then we have kind of a nice stereo spread of harmonies. I also have kind of some verse harmonies where there's just one, so I've automated that, so it's kind of panned right up the middle. We'll talk more about automation in a little bit. And then for the oohs, I definitely want to do some compression to kind of even out the attack and the sustain of that, and then just kind of wash them out in some reverb so it's more of a background texture, just to kind of push it farther back in the mix. So let's dive into individual tracks here. So we have the lead vocal, and the first thing I did, bring up Nectar. And one thing I always do kind of working with Nectar is use the vocal assistant. So if you click this and play back the audio, it'll listen and kind of give you a series of modules to select. And I love it because it does some initial EQing for you to kind of attenuate some harsh or undesirable frequencies. And so that's kind of what you see here. It identified, you know, some low mid frequencies around 880 hertz and 1300, some kind of more nasal frequencies, and then some harshness around 3600 hertz. And so I left these kind of right, you know, as it set them in the vocal assistant. And then for this one, I put this on frequency follow mode, which if you've used Nectar, you're familiar with. That way it kind of follows the fundamental harmonic around. And I ultimately wanted to kind of reduce some of the low end in a more even way. So this is awesome. So you can target a specific harmonic of the vocal and just attenuate that. I also did a low roll off at 110 hertz just to get rid of any kind of low end rumbling that might be in the recording. Another nice thing about Vocal Assistant is it sets my de-esser for me. And then I did kind of my own compression. So one other feature that I want to mention as well that's also set when you do Vocal Assistant is the auto level mode. So you can enable this, and then this is your target. And basically it helps even out your vocal performance so you don't have to do a whole bunch of manual gain writing. And this just allows you to not hit your compressor with, you know, super wild dynamics and get a little bit more of a transparent sound while having a very controlled performance level wise. So I am going to first kind of start off with the EQ, and we'll bring that in so you can hear kind of the effect that it's having on the vocal in solo. So here's the vocal just completely unprocessed, and then I'll bring in the EQ.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight.
With EQ.
Walking out of my front door, just to say that I went outside.
So I can solo this band so you can actually hear kind of what it's attenuating. So yeah, that can get a bit out of hand and start to compete with some of the guitars and keyboards and bass. So bringing that down just helps kind of clean up the overall sound. Then we have the de-esser. So let's find a good section here. Probably the chorus would be the best example with S's. So I'm going to start this and play through the chorus without the de-esser, and then I'll bring it in.
I don't want to fall asleep. I don't want to live my life like that, in front of a glowing screen. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen.
And I know I'm gonna be kind of brightening this vocal a lot, so I like doing the de-essing kind of early in the chain before compression and before that kind of tonal EQ adjustment, just to make sure that I'm working with a very kind of clean slate. So next we have some compression, really to add some tone as well as dynamics control. I use the solid state. So you have digital, which is the most transparent, vintage, optical, and then solid state. So I chose solid state. I liked the character of that. I have a 4-to-1 ratio and an attack time of 0.7 milliseconds, so super fast, and a little over 50 milliseconds for the release. So it's just a really, really quick peak reduction. This is, somewhat similar to an 1176 kind of setting, if you're familiar. So that is the first kind of compression I have going on. And I am gonna give you a sample of what that sounds like. I will play this back in the chorus and then bring it in halfway through.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand.
So you can see on the gain trace meter kind of how much it's attenuating those peaks. I also have kind of a second layer of compression that is kind of more so evening of the vocal overall. I'm using an optical compressor because they typically have a much slower, response time. I'm doing, 10 milliseconds attack, which is, somewhat more typical of an LA-2A, and 50 millisecond release time. And, have the auto gain on, so I don't have to worry about that. And I'm doing about, minus 3 dB of compression. So here's what that sounds like.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand.
So yeah, I like doing that serial compression, a super fast peak reduction compressor like the 1176, going into, a softer compressor like the LA-2A. They both impart their own unique tone and kind of help tame the peaks, but also kind of level out the overall performance. So when you need a lot of compression in a dense mix, that's a great classic combo to use. And then now with all the compression, it's sounding a little bit round and a little bit squishy, and I wanna bring some of that clarity back to it. So we're gonna do another round of EQ. It's almost kind of like a frequency tilt to it. You can see I brought up 5K, a good boost of 3.5 dB, a high shelf at about 10K, another couple dB, and then a small boost around 2K for some presence, almost a dB. And then I did some attenuation of the low end. So I was hearing a lot of murky muddiness around 350 hertz. So I brought that down a couple dB. And then I was also still getting a little bit too much low end in context. I have a dynamic band going because it let me just have a little bit more control when the proximity effect got a little bit strong. I also have a little bit of attenuation in some of the more kind of nasally frequencies around 670 hertz, just 1.5 dB there. So it makes quite a big difference. So I'm gonna play this back and I'll bring it in so you can hear.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight, walking out of my front door, just to say that I went outside.
That is the kind of the first layer of vocal processing. I felt like it still was needing a little bit more control. I really wanted to hear the detail of the end of my words come through. So a great way to achieve that is parallel compression, using a really fast compression setting that really squashes the vocal, and then just mixing that in just enough, and it kind of brings up all of the detail at the end of your words and kind of the quiet syllables without making your vocal sound, you know, completely squashed to a pancake. I also wanted to bring in a little bit of saturation, just to bring a little bit more energy and kind of presence to the vocal. And then, you know, this last EQ is just to kind of clean up what the saturation was adding, get rid of some harshness. I will show you this on the chorus, and it might have kind of the most impact there. And I'm gonna bring in, you know, a different module each time.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life second hand.
I also want to mention, actually, so in terms of the particulars, you know, 0.2 millisecond attack, 50 millisecond release, 8:1 ratio, minus 10 dB of attenuation, and 25% blend. And then for the exciter, I'll play this back in just a second. But I did this in two band mode because I just wanted to saturate more of the higher frequencies and not accentuate too much of that kind of low end. So I used a little bit of a blend of retro and tape algorithms and kind of brought this up. I pushed down some of the highest frequencies just so it didn't sound too kind of fizzy. And then I blended this down to a 45% kind of wet dry blend. So here's how it sounds with the exciter.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life second hand.
Just a little bit of edge and character that I think, you know, fits well with the more retro modern hybrid of this song. It's a little bit pop, but it's also rough around the edges. So that's what I was trying to go with on the vocals too. And then here's with some dynamic attenuation at 2K and 3.5K.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen.
So yeah, it just helps kind of tame some of those mid-range frequencies so they don't, you know, stab you in the ear when it gets a little bit louder. Okay, so that's all the processing to the dry vocal. Now it's time to give it some ambience, give it some dimension. I did kind of a gritty slapback delay was one of the first things I added to kind of add to the vibe of this track. So for this, I used BX Delay 2500 and I did 120 millisecond delay. A little bit of an offset, so it has some stereo kind of imaging to it. 5% feedback, and then I brought in the left and right channel just a little bit because I wanted it to feel stereo but not overly thrown out to the sides. I wanted it to blend a little bit more with the lead vocal. I high passed the delay around 280 hertz and then low passed it at 3700 just to give it, you know, more of a focus on the mid range so it's not, you know, competing with the vocal too much. I find that really helps with delay slaps or even long delays. You gotta cut out the lows and the highs to make sure that it's not competing with the vocal too much and it pushes it further back in the mix as well. I have some modulation going. That's the great thing about this plugin. There's a ton of different creative options, so you don't need to stack too many plugins. So a little bit of chorus and a little bit of distortion kind of blended in there. You have a tone shape control, which is awesome too, and then gain control. I will play this back with the delay, and then I will solo just the delay so you can hear it.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight, walking out of my front door, just to say that I went outside.
So yeah, very gritty kind of sound. So here is it in context.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight.
So yeah, it really helps it to kind of pop out from the mix and have, you know, it starts to have a sense of space to it. The next thing was reverb. I wanted to go with something a little bit retro. So vocal plate was kind of an obvious choice for that. And I used a couple different plugins to achieve the sound I was going for. So I used Reverb Assistant, which automatically kind of helps you unmask your original sound source by doing some pre-EQ and post-EQ on the reverb to make sure that the wet and dry signal aren't competing too much for the same frequencies. And then I darkened the plate quite a bit with a high shelf and then took out some low end as well with kind of low shelf there. So I also have about 78 milliseconds of pre-delay, which really helps give your vocal the ability to sit forward in the mix, but still have, you know, a good amount of reverb ambience coming through behind it. I will solo the vocal and play back just Neoverb.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight.
So it's still sounding a little bit too modern for me, so I added some saturation with the BX Saturator V2. I just used the gentle saturation setting here, and it did kind of just enough for me to bring out, you know, some density in the reverb and give it a little bit more grit.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight.
It also gives you kind of some natural like compression as well. The last thing I added was Ozone Imager, because I felt like a lot of older style reverbs were mono, so I wanted to make this feel a little bit more mono. I brought down the width slider to -55% to make it more narrow, and here's how that sounds.
Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight.
All right, the next send that I added on the lead vocal was another delay. I wanted to do kind of a long delay. So you can see I dialed in a lot more feedback. I have quarter note and an eighth note, so you get a little bit of stereo kind of bouncing back and forth. Rolled off low end, rolled off high end. I added some modulation, some distortion, just like on the slapback delay. But the other feature I wanted to point out here is ducking. And this is super helpful because typically I would have to add my delay and then add a compressor after it, sidechain the compressor to the lead vocal. If I wanted to kind of automatically attenuate the feedback of the delay when the vocal is going to make sure it doesn't mask. But in this plugin, the ducking is automatic and you can set your release time here and your amount right here, and it automatically does that ducking for you to sort of clean up the delay sound on the vocal. But as soon as the vocal ends, the delay feedback kind of, you know, blooms after it. Here's the vocal with the delay added as well.
I'm living life like I'm meant.
Okay, so there you go. That's the long delay. So I used that coming in and out of the pre-chorus, and then, you know, there's a little bit present kind of throughout the song. Okay, now that we have lead vocals done, let's talk about the vocal double. And so if you look at my chain, it's very similar for the lead vocal double. Typically, my starting place is I literally copy the same processing over. The difference is I'm typically adding less high frequencies and I'm attenuating more low frequencies, kind of paying mind to some of the harshness in the upper mid-range frequencies. I'm ultimately trying to craft the vocal in a way where it complements the lead and doesn't distract from it. You can see here, these EQ points were set with vocal assistant. I have my de-esser, compression, the same kind of serial compression chain as the lead vocal. And then this is where it actually differs from the other one. So I'll show you this one specifically. I have a higher kind of roll-off point at 200 hertz. So getting rid of everything below 200, attenuating at 350 hertz. I have some dynamic bands at 1700 and about 3K to get rid of some of that harshness, like I mentioned, that can build up with multiple layers. A high frequency boost in the top end. I'm going to play this back and I'm going to bypass everything. I'm going to bring in each bit of processing kind of one by one.
I don't want to fall asleep. I don't want to live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that.
The next thing is the de-esser. Just classic, you know, de-esser you can hear right here.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen.
So yeah, the way I set this is output S only, just to make sure it's only removing kind of the S's. So yeah, that sounds good to me. And the reason I'm doing additional de-essing is because I don't want sort of that phasing sound you can get from S's overlapping with the harmonies and the doubles and all of that. So sometimes doing a little bit of extra de-essing is necessary just to kind of make room for the lead vocal. You only really need one S coming from your main vocal. So again, here's how that sounds.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that.
And then I did some similar processing, again with some parallel compression, so the exact same settings as the lead vocal. And then I did some tape saturation as well and increased it even further. And then, yeah, some harshness reduction and kind of a small notch around 500 hertz. For this, I will just play this back and then bypass the processing and then bring it in so you can hear the difference.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand.
So yeah, it really punches up the vocals for that chorus section. Quite a bit of saturation so that, you know, when it's layered with kind of the main vocal, it gives it, you know, a grittier, kind of edgier texture. We have all of that together, and then we have some sound effects. So have the vocal slap.
Don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like
that. And then the reverb.
In front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand.
And here's how that sounds with the lead vocal for context.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen.
And then in context with the rest of the instrumental.
I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen.
Awesome. So let's move on to vocal harmonies. Similar to vocal doubles, I typically start with the same processing chain as the lead vocal. And then kind of from there, I'll kind of mold it and craft it to have its own space. Usually that involves, you know, getting rid of some of the low mid frequencies, getting rid of some of the high frequencies, you know, leaving those for the lead vocal to kind of have more presence and more warmth. And really the harmonies are going to be a bit more mid-range focused, and the goal is just to have them blend really nicely with everything. So here's how they sound without any processing.
Fall asleep. Don't wanna live my life like that. Glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand.
So yeah, I have them kind of edited in a way where they're specifically aligning with certain phrases and words. And so let's bring up our processing chain, which is gonna look very familiar. We have, you know, same basic EQ settings as the lead vocal, some de-essing, serial compression, and then the EQ. So this is where it differs. We have less low end. I have a pretty shallow sloped high pass filter starting at 260 hertz. I have some dynamic bands at 2K and 3K to get rid of some of the harsh frequencies competing with the lead vocal. A little bit of a presence boost in the high end, but then also a roll off around 11K because I want to, again, leave some of that high frequency kind of detail to the lead vocal and kind of push the harmonies back. And when you get rid of the air frequencies, it has the effect often of kind of giving it a sense of being farther back in the mix. I'm going to play back these vocals and I will bring in each module one at a time so you can hear kind of the progressive sound.
Fall asleep. Don't wanna live my life like that. Glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand. Fall asleep. Don't wanna live my life like that. Glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand.
And here is the same processing chain in Neutron that I used on the lead vocals. Some parallel compression. Again, some tape retro blend saturation to just the higher frequencies. And then just a little bit of attenuation. I have some dynamic attenuation here. It's kind of acting as a bit of a de-esser just to push down any of those harsh consonants or S's that might compete with the lead vocal.
Fall asleep. Don't want to live my life like that. Glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand. Don't want to live my life like that. Glowing screen.
And then we have our send effects. I have a vocal slap.
Fall asleep.
We have our vocal plate.
Don't wanna live my life like that.
And then here we have a delay throw. And so I'm using this for the pre-chorus. I really liked the sound of the harmonies going through this delay instead of the melody. I just thought it was kind of an interesting thing. So I'm gonna play this back with the lead vocals so you can kind of hear them together.
And just pretend I'm living life like I meant.
So you can hear that quarter note delay kind of echo of the ends of some of those phrases. And that is the vocal harmonies. And then finally, we have some background vocals. And so here is how those sound, just as a reminder.
Ooh, ooh.
So yeah, obviously I'm gonna want some delay and reverb to kind of really space these out. I also want to compress them, give them some dynamic consistency so the beginning of the ooh doesn't, you know, really kind of shoot above where I want it volume wise, and the sort of sustain of that can be, you know, a little bit louder so it comes through in the mix. So starting with EQ, one of the things I wanted to do is kind of thin out this sound. But yeah, just get rid of some of the congested mid frequencies. And so here is how it sounds after EQ.
Ooh, ooh.
And then we have compression. So I'm using the optical compressor because the phrases are pretty soft. There's not a lot of significant transients. I just want kind of an overall leveling of the vocal. So optical compressors are a little bit softer. 10 millisecond attack and a 110 millisecond release. And here's how that sounds. A little bit of tape saturation to just add a little bit more texture, just kind of glue them together. Here's how that sounds.
Ooh, ooh.
And then I used the delay module. Here I have an eighth note and quarter note delay. And the reason I used it in line is because I wanted to be sending those delays into the reverb. And it was just convenient and easy having the module right here. So here's how that sounds. And then we have a background reverb. This is, you know, a much longer reverb. I darkened it a little bit, and then it has less of a pre-delay, which will push these vocals a little bit further back in the mix as well. Okay, so here's how that sounds. And here it is in context. Okay, so after I have all the tracks feeling good and working well together, I move on to automation. I'm gonna open the automation here and just kind of walk through where I've used it. So I guess the first place that you're gonna notice is I have my different vocal effect sends. I have automation in terms of level. So you can see for the vocal long delay, I have some automation on volume that's happening in the pre-chorus. So I'll play back the vocal in this section, and you'll be able to hear the long delay and how it kind of comes into focus during the pre-chorus here.
Not ready to do this all again and just pretend I'm living life like I meant.
And then I have a little bit more of the delay during the chorus as well. I do the same thing later. So that's one way I use automation, is to kind of bring up different effect sends in different sections of the song. Another layer to this delay is I actually did some automation. So if I click on this track, I have a send from my send going into the long kind of background vocal reverb, because I wanted to just add a splash of reverb onto my delay tail. You'll hear the delay, and then you'll all of a sudden hear the delay get a little kind of wetter.
Not ready to do this all again and just pretend. Don't wanna fall asleep.
So you can hear the difference in the chorus versus the pre-chorus. It just gets a little bit more spacey and washed out. You can get some pretty fun combinations of different effects blended together. So the other effect I used some automation for was the vocal plate. My main vocal, kind of during the verse, it's a little bit more subdued. During the chorus, it's a little bit louder. So I'll play just this section of pre-chorus going into the chorus.
I'm living life like I meant. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that.
So there you go. Another way that you can use this is to actually automate the level of the reverb up on certain phrases. So I have a transitional phrase here going into the pre-chorus.
Not ready to do this all again.
So yeah, it just kind of blooms out a little bit bigger right there. So that's the great thing about automation, is it's your chance to really create, you know, dynamic movement in the mix. Another thing you'll see is down here I have my delay throw, because I'm just trying to throw certain phrases or words into that delay. So I'm gonna solo just the harmonies so you can really hear kind of what it's doing.
And just pretend.
So yeah, I really like that for the very tail end of words, just to kind of throw them into a delay, to be able to create that sense of space and movement without completely cluttering the vocals and hurting the intelligibility of the vocal. And then some volume adjustments just between kind of the verse harmonies and the chorus, and then some panning adjustments. So one cool trick, you know, to make your choruses feel even wider is if you have harmonies during the verses, to have them panned more towards the center, and then during the chorus, have them, you know, pan really wide. And actually, I'll just play it in context so you get a more realistic picture. So the harmony is going to be in the center, and then all of a sudden it's going to turn into a, you know, a stereo harmony vocal and go out to the sides. Just one additional way I use automation is actually automating the lead vocal and specifically trying to bring up different syllables that might be getting buried. And so this is, you know, kind of the last step of vocal mixing actually for me. So you can see, you know, a bunch of different phrases pulled up here. Typically, I'll get the level of the vocal kind of sitting right where I want it, with maybe certain phrases are getting slightly buried. And then I'll go in and automate those phrases up and just add a little bit more dynamic consistency that way. It's a very subtle effect, but I'll turn off all of this automation and then I will turn it on so you can hear the difference. Hanging out on the front porch, watching as the neighbors fight. Hanging out on the front porch, watching. So yeah, it's nothing drastic, just a dB here and there, sometimes a dB and a half. Just helps kind of bring up, you know, some of those syllables or, you know, half of a word that might start to trail off. And this is also where I might do some adjustment, like bring up the vocal in the chorus so it's a bit louder, because typically there's more instruments it's competing with. In this case, I had a vocal double supporting it, so I actually didn't really need to bring up the lead vocal during the chorus as much. So for this, I really just wanted to create more movement in the vocals, so primarily all of my automation is focused on vocals and vocal effects. All right, so one of the last things I'll do on a mix is some submix processing. And in my template, I separate that into three buses. So my A bus is the rhythm bus, so it's drums and bass and percussion, everything that's kind of driving the rhythm of the song. I have the instrument bus, which is your stringed instruments, keys, synthesizers, other kind of melodic sounds and effects, and then the vocal bus, which is all of the vocals. And so I really like doing it this way because it really helps me start to zoom out on my mix and think about, you know, the instrument groups and how, you know, I can further enhance those. This is kind of my last chance to really enhance the mix before it gets handed off to mastering. Or at least, you know, if I'm mastering it, it lets me do, you know, just a little bit more refinement from a zoomed out perspective. So let's tackle the rhythm bus first. So again, this is all of the drums and the percussion. I started with some EQ, and really my goal here was just to, you know, can I make the drum sound, you know, even cooler? Is there any issues that are popping out to me as I'm hearing the drums, you know, with the congas and with the shakers and everything else? You know, does it need just like a little bit more? And in this case, I felt like, you know, I had some room to kind of bump a little bit more low end. So I boosted about 120 hertz so I would get that kind of extension of the bass, you know, all the way down to the kick drum. I attenuated a little bit at 300 hertz just because it can get a little bit muddy around that zone, especially with a lot of the keyboards and guitars. So, and then bringing a little bit more snap to it, a little bit more presence. I also engaged a bit of soft saturation, which is again kind of similar to an EQ on a console. It imparts a certain harmonic color to the signal as well. And then we have some compression. We have a 30 millisecond attack time and an 85 millisecond release time, 2-to-1 ratio, just really trying to glue everything together rhythmically. And one note on this is I engaged a sidechain high pass filter so that the low end I just added doesn't, you know, trigger the compressor too much. And so I did a roll off just above 100 hertz to make sure the kick drum isn't, you know, making the compressor pump on everything else. And then the last thing I did was add a little bit of saturation with the exciter, and I didn't touch the low end as much, so I divided them with a band around 135 hertz. So the low end extension of the bass and the kick drum aren't being saturated quite as much. So I have some tube saturation going, only about 30% blend. I like tube saturation. I feel like it can really help fatten up drums and percussive sounds in a really cool way. I'm gonna play this back and then I'll bring it in. The next bus is the instrument bus. And so, like I said, this is all of the guitars and strings and stringed instruments, keys and other sound effects. So here's a sample of that. So this is where I think there's a lot of possibility to compete with the vocal. So that's going to be definitely a consideration for me. I also don't want it to compete with the low end, the bass, and the drums. So I have a high pass filter at close to 80 hertz. I also did some attenuation of 600 hertz and 2.1 kilohertz. I noticed there's a little bit of masking happening with the vocals. Just tucking these back a little bit just makes a bit more room. So I'm gonna bring in the lead vocal here so you can hear the difference there. I'm gonna play this back without the EQ and then with it. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life second. So yeah, just enough, it kind of gets the guitars and keys out of the way of the vocals. And then I did a little bit of excitement, the tape algorithm, just to kind of glue everything together. I will play it back bypassed and then bring it in. All right, and then we have the vocal bus. And so again, you know, I'm trying to glue together these different layers, kind of make them feel, you know, cohesive together and also address any frequency buildup issues. Sometimes with several layers of vocals, you can get a lot of harshness in the presence range. So kind of around anywhere from 2K to 5K. I rolled off again at about 95 hertz to make sure there was no kind of low frequency rumbling, nothing generated by the effects, because I have all the effects are routed to the corresponding bus along with the dry signals. I attenuated a little bit at 930 hertz. There was just a little bit of kind of nasaliness building up there. And then a dynamic band at 3300 hertz, which is kind of where I was sensing a little bit of harshness happening. I'm going to bypass this and then I'll bring in just the EQ. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand. And then I have some compression to glue everything together. 10 millisecond attack, 2-to-1 ratio. And 100 millisecond release time. Here that is without compression, then I'll bring it in. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that in front of a glowing screen. Living my whole life secondhand. And just for fun, I'm gonna play back just the chorus section with all of the processing on the submix buses bypassed, and then I'll play it back with them enabled. All right, so the last thing we're gonna do is kind of a rough master on this track. Now that everything's mixed, I can kind of zoom out in my perspective and start to compare this to references and think about, you know, is this, you know, too bright? Is this too dark? Is there anything off in the frequency tonal balance of things? And a super helpful tool to check your work is Tonal Balance Control. You can play a section of your song and it'll give you the displayed average energy of your song across the frequency spectrum. And then you can compare that to a bunch of different genre targets just to see, you know, do I have way too much low end? Do I have too much high end? Not enough? And kind of check your work in a more objective way. I'm gonna leave this on the rock setting here, and I'm gonna play back the pre-chorus going into the chorus and kind of see where this lands. Just pretend I'm living life like I meant. I don't wanna fall asleep. I don't wanna live my life like that. In front of a glowing screen, living my So I'm actually surprised. It's actually pretty much right on target. One thing you'll notice is when I started playing the track, there was a significant dip in kind of the low mid-range, and it looked like there might be too much high-end as well. Typically, I always want to reference the chorus of a song, and I want to let it play at least 20 to 30 seconds at bare minimum to make sure that it gets a good average reading. The only thing I was seeing was there might be a little bit too much super high end here, like above 15K, which could, you know, make it sound a little bit more modern than I was going for. That might be something, you know, I look at attenuating with Ozone. Another super helpful tool to use when you're mixing or when you're mastering is Insight. There's a ton of different tools in here that can help you get an idea of the loudness of your track, where it's peaking, the stereo field, even kind of looking at a spectrogram to be able to just see visually kind of what's happening with your audio. So typically, you know, I might be looking at the sound field meter, the standard RMS and peak meter, and then the loudness rating. I'm trying to look at, you know, what is my loudness compared to my reference. Another thing I keep an eye on is dynamic range. So typically I don't want my RMS and my peak level being less than 10 dB apart, because then you're kind of squashing your dynamic range quite a bit. So as I play this back, you'll see all these meters kind of light up. All right, so let's look at my mastering chain. So I have BX Refinement up first, and what this plugin does is help reduce harshness. So it's an awesome way to get rid of some of the edginess in your upper mid-range in a very transparent way. You can control the amount of damping here, and then you can control your dynamics range, the speed of the processing, and even add saturation and bring back some presence. There's also a mid-side mode, just a ton of different things that you can do. For this, I used the subtle D-harsh preset, and it was kind of doing just enough for me to ease back some of that mid-range kind of edginess. So I'm gonna play back the chorus, and I will start with this bypassed and then bring it in so you can hear the effect. So if I play this back and kind of increase some of these settings, you know, to the extreme, you can really hear it start to push down the upper mid range. So obviously that's way too much attenuation. It's starting to sound super muffled and weird. And that's the beauty of this plugin. You can go to extremes, but you can also do very subtle work for mastering. And then the next thing I did was grab Ozone. And the first thing I did was I used the mastering assistant. So I set it to modern, you know, intensity medium. And then I let it listen to my track to the loudest section of it in the chorus and set my initial settings for me. And I like doing this again, similar to Tonal Balance Control. It can be a way to check your work. From there, I will make my own decisions about kind of what I want to do with it. When I ran Master Assistant, the EQ was pretty much completely flat, slightly attenuated in the high end. For me, I decided to do that in the high end, kind of bring it down a little bit, but also to bring back a little bit of presence. And specifically, I did this in mid-side mode, and I only applied that to the mid channel so that I could keep kind of the high frequency material of like the shakers and some of the other panned percussion instruments. I wanted to keep those very kind of bright and exciting in the sides, but the drum overheads and the center vocals, I wanted just to darken a tiny bit. So I'm gonna play this back. Awesome. And then the next thing I did was a little bit of bus compression. And so for this, I have a 2-to-1 ratio, 30 millisecond attack, 100 millisecond release. I'm doing, you know, about 85% wet dry. This is just to really glue the whole mix together, add a little bit more density to it. Having 30 millisecond attack time allows the transients to get through, keeps it, you know, feeling energetic and punchy. I'm going to play this back and then bring in the dynamics. And then the next thing I did was add a little bit of saturation with the exciter. So I put this in mid-side mode because my main goal here was actually to create stereo width of the effects, the reverbs, the delays. I used tape saturation and just dialed in a little bit more on the sides. So I'm going to play this back and bring it in. Okay, and then the next thing is the dynamic EQ module. So this is another awesome benefit of using Master Assistant is it'll automatically kind of set the frequency points and the dynamic reduction in places where it's gonna help your limiter sound more transparent. So I left this exactly how Master Assistant set it to make sure that Maximizer wasn't creating too many artifacts in the process of limiting and kind of getting it to the loudness I want. So here's the mix without dynamic EQ, and then I'll bring it in. And then the last thing is the maximizer, which actually is typically the first thing that I will add in my mastering chain just to kind of reach the amount of level that I want. I find that it's helpful to first do your limiting because that's going to have an impact on the end results of your track and the low end and the high end and, you know, potential distortion. So it's good to know upfront how the limiter is going to interact with your mix. I use the same basic settings that Master Assistant gave me, but I raised the ceiling to minus 0.3 dB and I brought down the threshold a bit more to achieve a little bit more loudness, trying to aim for some of the same loudness ratings of my reference tracks. Here is how that sounds. I selected gain match right here so we can have a little bit more of an even comparison. I'm gonna play this in bypass and then bring it in. I don't wanna live. other thing I wanted to point out is you have this super handy feature here where you can monoize your whole mix to make sure it's mono compatible. That's super important to do because people might be listening on different types of speakers and more mono systems. So it's good to always just double check that, make sure that big parts of your mix don't kind of collapse or disappear. And then you also have a channel switch button, which swaps the left and the right channel. So you can have a way to kind of hear your mix in a different light and then be able to hear if there's anything that's a little off balance left or right. I'm gonna play this back and show you kind of what those features sound like. So there you go. There is my rough master of sleepwalking. And here is an example of the song before mixing and then after mixing with tools from Music Production Suite 5. All right, thank you so much for watching. If you want to learn more about Music Production Suite 5, head over to iZotope.com, and I'll see you guys in the next one.